In the first four videos in this series, we talked about the basics of attachment theory, why dependency on others is healthy, how to identify your own attachment style along with the style of the people you date, and went into detail on the anxious attachment style. In this video, we'll dive into the avoidant attachment style, including what traits it has and how to have better relationships if you have this style. And if you find that you're always looking for the one, or discover that no one's ever as good as the one that got away, keep watching, because we'll discuss why that is and what you can do about it. Avoidant people tend to idealize self-sufficiency and independence, but even for these people, companionship is important. They too enjoy life's experiences most when shared with others, so they do actually want someone in their life, but they tend to pull away when they get too close to someone. The research is clear. If you have an avoidant attachment style, you tend to be less happy and satisfied in your relationships. The avoidant attachment style provides strength in a world where people are unreliable or disappear often, whether by choice or because they're killed, but in today's modern world, and especially in romantic relationships, it's a disadvantage. Studies have shown that avoidants are quick to think negatively about their partners and see them as needy and overly dependent. This is a big part of how they view relationships, and it causes them to neglect their own needs. They look down on others for being needy and think that they're immune to those needs. This is not actually true. When distracted by other things, they lose their ability to actively suppress their needs. They think they're independent because they have an attachment system that uses mental effort to suppress their own needs. When life is stressful, however, and they don't have the mental capacity to suppress their own needs, they behave like people with an anxious attachment style. Avoidant people have a need for intimacy just like everyone else, but their attachment system makes them think they don't. It's very common for avoidant people to feel a deep sense of aloneness even when in a relationship. While secure people find it easy to connect and accept people as they are, avoidant people struggle with this. There's always some mental and emotional distance between them and their partners, and this leaves avoidant people feeling less satisfied in their relationships than other types. While anxious types have activation strategies that rile up their attachment system, avoidants have deactivation strategies that calm theirs down. Deactivation strategies are the thoughts and behaviors that suppress the feeling of connectedness and intimacy. Avoidants use them because they think they're protecting their autonomy, but really they're preventing their own happiness. Examples of deactivation strategies include focusing on insignificant imperfections in their partner, like how they dress or the sound that they make when they chew, and pulling away emotionally when things are going well in the relationship. Avoidants will commonly get freaked out when they get too close to someone and will disappear for a few days as a deactivation strategy. Avoidants often talk about the one, or how great an ex of theirs was and how no one else will ever be able to compare. They also often date people knowing that there's no chance it'll work out. They do this because they don't feel ready to commit, so temporary relationships are comforting. Avoidants tend to flirt with other people, even when in a relationship, and often make their partner feel insecure about where they stand. The lack of clarity as to where the relationship is going helps them keep their sense of independence. They often avoid physical and emotional closeness. They may not want to sleep in the same bed, hold hands in public, or say I love you. All these deactivation strategies help them feel less attached and thus more comfortable. Avoidants view their partner's behaviors differently than other types and are usually unaware of their distorted views. They focus heavily on self-reliance and see it as some sort of great strength that they possess. This makes them feel strong, like they don't need anyone else, but they also score lowest on every measure of closeness and personal relationships. They're less willing to seek help or be honest about their feelings and are the most uncomfortable with intimacy. They value their independence, but don't recognize the strength that can be gained by having another person involved. Two people that depend on one another can be much stronger than two independent people are alone. Avoidants often focus so much on themselves that they ignore the needs of their partners. They think they're able to fulfill their own needs just fine, and their partners should do the same. Avoidants also tend to focus on the bad qualities of their partners. They always come up with reasons why the relationship can't possibly work out. Studies have shown that people with an avoidant attachment style rate their partners less positively than non-avoidants. Even more telling, people with an avoidant attachment style rate their partners less positively even on days when their partners are warm, caring, and supportive. As you can see, this negative attitude about their partners is not based on the partner's behavior because even good behavior is rated negatively. This is because avoidants have a dismissive attitude toward connectedness. When their partner behaves in a loving and supportive manner, they're likely to ignore it or diminish its value. What happens is, as the relationship gets closer, the avoidant focuses more and more on the negative. Then they break up, and when the threat of intimacy is over, the deactivation strategies stop, and the avoidant person can see all the good that their partner brought, causing the avoidant person to appreciate them only after the relationship is over. Avoidant people tend to be the worst type at reading the emotional needs of others. To To make matters worse, they tell themselves it's not their job to meet other people's emotional needs, and that those people just need to learn to be more independent. This makes their relationships hard because their partners complain about not receiving enough emotional support, so there's less satisfaction, warmth, and connectedness in their relationships. Avoidants need to learn that meeting the needs of their partners is their duty and responsibility, rather than focusing only on their own needs and getting defensive when their partners express dissatisfaction. Avoidants often focus on the perfect partner. They're always seeking the one and think that their relationships would be just fine if they could find the right person. Sometimes this person is someone they haven't met yet, and other times it's the one that got away. Because they devalue romantic relationships when they're in them, it's often not until a relationship is long over that they appreciate what their partner did for them. This is why it's so common for them to get back with an ex after having walked away months earlier. If that ex is an anxious type, as is often the case, there's a good chance they're still obsessing about the avoidant partner because the anxious don't move on as quickly as the secures, and so they're more likely to be willing to get back together with them. This can result in rocky on-again, off-again relationships that go on for years. If they're not able to get back with their ex, they may think longingly about this long-lost love and compare all future partners to them. Since they're always devaluing their current relationship, this will make it seem like no one can ever measure up to the one that got away. This is called the phantom ex phenomenon. Now that there's no danger of intimacy, they stop with the deactivation strategies and appreciate all the good parts of their relationship with their ex. If there were real problems, they often forget what those were and why the relationship had to end. This love of past relationships acts as a deactivation strategy for new relationships, preventing closeness and making the new partner seem insignificant by comparison. Another problem with believing in the one is that sometimes you think you found them, but then suddenly something comes up that annoys you or you discover that they're not as attractive as you once thought they were. You take this to mean that they must not be the one, rather than recognizing that this is your deactivation strategy being triggered to turn off your attachment needs. You're not turned off because they're not right for you. You're turned off because you have a problem with intimacy and closeness with anyone, even the one, and this causes you to pull away. When you pull away, your partner protests, and that just makes you that much more certain that they're not the one. Avoidant people tend to believe that external circumstances are why they're unable to find happiness in relationships. They fail to recognize that they're their own problem and the reason for their dissatisfaction. They're often so independent-minded that they refuse to get help even when their partner requests they go to couples counseling. It often takes reaching a low point in their life for avoidance to change their thinking. But all is not lost. If you're an avoidant and are looking for ways you can have better relationships, here are a few tips you can use. The first thing you can do is recognize deactivation strategies when you use them. If the idea suddenly comes into your head that someone you really like isn't right for you, ask if this is a serious problem or just your deactivation strategy coming into play. Next, focus less on self-reliance and more on mutual support. Because of the dependency paradox we talked about in the second video, the more secure your partner feels, the less they need to work to get close to you, and the less activated your desire to pull away. You also both are better able to focus outwardly and do your own things and be more independent if the relationship has a secure base. Third, find a secure partner and avoid anxious ones. Secure partners make their partners feel more secure, while an anxious partner is likely to exacerbate your avoidance. Be grateful for your partner while you're in the relationship. It's worth remembering on a daily basis that you tend to think negatively of your partner, and so find at least one good thing every day that you can appreciate. Be conscious of your tendency to misinterpret what your partner does. Notice when you're assuming the worst about your partner and instead look for a more plausible explanation of the behavior. Trust that your partner is looking out for you and your best interest. Let go of the phantom ex. Remember that that relationship ended for a reason, that they were and still are not a viable partner. Remember how critical you were of that relationship at the time. On that same note, forget about finding the one. Realize that there's no magical soulmate that will be everything you ever wanted and will make your deactivation strategies stop happening. You have to make someone into your soulmate by letting them get close and choosing to be with them. Finally, take advantage of distractions. Studies show that deactivation strategies take mental effort and are difficult to do when your mind is busy. Distractions make it harder to focus on the negative and deactivation strategies, so keep busy and do things with your partner so that your mind isn't free to sabotage the relationship. If you're finding this video helpful, give it a like and leave a comment about what it's like to have an avoidant attachment style or to date someone who does. In the sixth video in this series, we'll talk about the secure attachment style and how to develop one if you have a different style, so keep watching.